Everyone, and welcome to West Ham Fan TV's end of season preview. About 2 weeks too late, but we're here. Scott's just had a new baby, that's the reason why we couldn't get in the studio. But congratulations, Scott.
Well done, mate. Well done.
Thank you. Put you up.
Very much so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. That's what parenting is. Just a quick review of the season. We've got a load of points to go through, and we'll go through them. Just quickly though, as we go into it, how much have you enjoyed the season?
Very much so.
It's been my best season.
Yeah, the training factor's back.
We had the opportunity to finish our highest ever, but we fell short at the end. But for the entertainment factor, playing good football, big wins, great goals, no fear, players, had everything apart from a trophy.
Do you think the main aim for Bilic this year was to build a base to build on the next year when all the money starts coming in?
Yeah, of course.
You've got that set of players now that we can sort of start building on.
Yeah, that's it. You know, he would have come in under
no illusion.
Like we built around Noble this season. Now we've got to build around Payet, Lanzini,
exactly,
and players like that now, and we've got to improve the squad to take that step. This is always a pressured season for Bilic this year, being the last at the Bowling. His first.
They would have just said, make sure we're managing the stadium.
Yeah, yeah. First time managing in the Premier League as well.
Mm.
It's tough.
How much is down to the manager, what we've achieved this season?
A lot of it. Yeah. I said he's brought that no fear attitude, hasn't he? This team's more together than we've seen our teams in a long time.
Yeah, there's good team spirit this season. Mm. You see it before every game. Everyone goes around to each other. And I don't know if you see that little clip with the Betway thing in the change room.
Yeah, the team talk.
Well, you can see that's what Bilic does on match days. Gets them all in a circle, you know, goes around.
That Betway, he's cool as fuck, isn't he? He's cool as shit.
He's brilliant.
Yeah, and another thing he's done this season, he hasn't put the blame on any of the players when we've lost or made mistakes, and he gives them the praise, and he will take the blame if we lose.
My favourite part about him as a man, apart from just him being probably the world's coolest man, is the post-match interviews. I think it's refreshing to hear an honest manager that isn't blaming everything but himself.
Mm.
You look at, I'm not going to go back to him, but you look at the difference between his and Allardyce's interviews. They're a contrast apart.
Yeah, you know? It's only that as well. He don't sit down, does he?
No.
It's nice to see for the first minute to the 90, he's standing up. He don't sit down.
No.
He's playing that game on the touchline.
I wonder who's got a bad hip.
That's what he's doing. He's playing the game on the touchline.
He's out there going with the players. Every ball, every header.
At the end of the day, he can only do a certain amount. It's when the players cross that white line, they're the ones that...
But he gives them the belief that they can go out and do that.
Right, let's talk about him a little bit more, because we want to go through some of these afterwards. I mean, because we want to go through some of these things now. So we've got 1 to 12 subjects here. I'll give you the subject and you just tell me what it is, right? Do you know what I mean? You give me the answer. So number one, I've got game of the season. Graham.
I'm going to go for sheer excitement. Arsenal at home, 3-0. Just for coming back and 2-0 down, leading 3-2. It had everything. It was end to end, the tackles flying in. It was a proper London derby. Mm.
Yeah, that was a good game. Scott?
It's a tough one. I've got two. I know I'm not allowed to, but I'm going to go for the Liverpool extra time winner, that game.
That was a fantastic
game.
I watched that on the telly in America.
That was nearly, you know, that and the last game of the season for the emotion.
No, the one.
Yeah, the Liverpool one for me. Winning that right at the death.
That was a fantastic game, that. One?
Everton away. That game for me had everything. 2-0 down with 15 minutes to go against Everton.
Mm.
I think it was more that the fans that were giving us stick. They missed a penalty. And then when Payet scored that winner, I went over about five rows. And
it's because of the stick we'd been getting in the lead up to it as well, and all the tin pot club, and there's been this animosity brewing between the two sets of fans.
For me, it was that was my favourite game of the season.
Well, I'm going to go with the obvious. It's the final bowling game, the Man United game. I think that had everything. I think that was another one that had everything in it. People say about having everything in games, like having penalties and red cards. I'm glad that game didn't have them. Do you know what I mean? Penalties and red cards and things, because it sort of ruins it. And people were always saying, oh yeah, it was a dodgy penalty and all that, apart from what happened before and all the media surrounding that. But just for, you know, 1-0 up, 2-1 down, and then coming back, you know, it looked for a long time like we wasn't going to get back in it, and then all of a sudden we just kicked into life, and it was just a fitting end for the ground.
To be honest, I mean, I could have had about 5 or 6.
Yeah, it's been that sort of season.
I didn't think anything was going to top Arsenal away from me at the beginning of the season, but for me, Everton away.
All right, but let's break it down a little bit now. Worst game of the season. Do you know what? There ain't many, but...
No, there's not many, but... Go on, lad.
Tottenham away. Worst game of the season for me.
Why?
It was just awful. Everything about it was awful.
Or just the scoreline.
The scoreline, the fact it was there. And
Jenkinson.
It was just terrible. Absolutely terrible.
Right?
Yeah, I was going to say Tottenham away as well, just for losing to Tottenham 4-1. I can't really think of many other games. I was trying to think of a home and...
I couldn't bloody think of one. Swansea.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right at the death. The importance of the game as well, which was a bit of a letdown. But to be fair, there's not many times I can say we haven't turned up this season. But that was the one rare occasion where we just didn't turn up.
Well, I'm going for the FA Cup quarter final replay for me. We didn't turn up. We deserved to win up at Old Trafford. It was in our hands, and we just, I don't know if it was the occasion or what, we just didn't seem to turn up. Man, you wanted it more. You know, I really thought that it was Ryan. Well, we all did. I thought it was going to be our year. I thought we were going to get to Wembley and win the cup. And I was pretty gutted after that one, I've got to be honest.
Yeah, I think that was a bit disappointing, the Man United game. You two might as well go over there and have this. Best away ground?
Swansea. I like Swansea. Nice place. Nice ground. Nice people.
When you say best away ground, would you mean like the stadium?
No, when I say best away ground, I mean that's probably worded a little bit wrong. I mean best
away day.
Day, yeah, I suppose. not for the purely the football, but you know the atmosphere around the ground and
mine was Leicester.
Yeah, I was going to say Leicester.
I was brilliant.
That's why.
Leicester was brilliant.
Nah, Leicester.
I'm miserable.
I'll be right on that one.
Nah, Leicester was great. If you're going for just the day, like, and it was a good, like, because Leicester,
that was
fans
good.
Were buzzing.
That was
when
a good
game. It was a good game. Yeah. We had a few drinks before and after.
Yeah.
But if you're going on stadium, I'd say the Emirates for me.
Yeah.
Lovely stadium. Be the second best next.
Well, it's a combination of everything. Mine was, I'd say, I'm with him, Swansea. I thought the stadium was a nice stadium.
Mm-hmm.
People were friendly. The people in the bars were friendly. Wasn't overly zealous. Good food, good drink.
Do you know what, I'll be honest with you. Every away game we've been this season, there's been no trouble anywhere, has there?
No, I can't think of
that. We've been in pubs with away
except
fans.
Tottenham.
Yeah, but that's just the different. They don't count.
But it was a lot of circumstances leading up to the trouble that was there. You know, the problems we had outside the ground led from things that happened away from the ground. So,
what? Did you answer? What,
yeah, you said Leicester.
Yeah.
Oh, Leicester. Okay. The worst away ground. Worst away day you had.
Away ground. Well, worst away day for me was obviously Tottenham, but our ground, Selhurst Park. Shit room. Shit stadium.
I'm going to agree with you on both of them.
Shit
points.
Pubs. Yeah, I just... Great
shit,
win.
Shit pubs. I went there in season 4, I thought it was alright.
Yeah, but that's you.
Did you... You weren't there, was you?
Nah, it's, I think it's because we've...
I've been there before.
I'm going on this season. Yeah, I'm going on this season because we was right near the top and you couldn't see nothing.
I still remember filming that post-match pilot thing over the camera.
Yeah.
I'd say that not for the ground, because it's a massive ground. It was Old Trafford. It was just the general attitude of the staff up there, and all that spoiled it for me.
I was going to say the same thing. It was it's the stadium's a magnificent stadium, but the attitude of people, the attitude of the staff, you get that sort of sense of like, yeah, you're in our territory now, and you're not well. You don't feel welcome. I didn't feel welcome.
Wouldn't let us film fan cams, would they?
No. It
took us about 20 stewards to get through to the security guards to get in. They searched us loads of times, didn't they?
Mm.
See, that's the thing for me, the whole away experience of a Tottenham game. But even, you know, it was probably one of the worst things that you could go through. The travelling there, trying to get home was a nightmare. The fact that we got stuffed the way we did made it even worse. But then other than, but the view we had at Palace, you know, that was a great team performance, but it was shocking. Yeah.
The ground at Goodison, I must give that a special mention, because that is like an old ship. Isn't it? Do you know what I mean?
It's
not
great, isn't it?
Let's get into some of the stuff that we want to hear about. The fan cam of the season. We've obviously interviewed hundreds of fans this season. Everyone, thanks for everyone for coming up. But who stuck out for you? Let's got answer because you've answered.
For me, it's Dom's thingy of Andy Carroll. For me, that was a fan cam.
Unicorn to
A donkey to a unicorn, whatever it is, a unicorn. That was my favourite fan cam.
Dom's been great this season, but for me, there's only one man, Nathan Ever, in the way.
Yeah. No, do you know what? to be honest with you, you didn't come, and me and him was there. Him at Liverpool away as well, wasn't it?
Mm.
He's had a good cut.
I tell you, but the Everton one was special. Mm. Was that the one? Oh, it was Blackburn. When it's, if we lose this, I'll run the marathon.
Everton away was more dead than Elvis, and we could win the boat race. That just. But you know, I've got so many, like Arsenal away first game of the season. They were special. That was good. Palace away when I was interviewing little Max, and then everyone. That was when the Payet song first started, wasn't it? You was filming, and then everyone just come over and I had people kissing me. And
Liverpool was good. Liverpool was good for that. Believe in Bilic.
Yeah,
that was a memorable one.
Fake Andy Carroll.
Yeah, the fake Andy Carroll. Yeah, there's a few, isn't there? There's been some good fan cams, but no. For me, Nathan wins it hands down. Absolutely brilliant.
Thank you to everyone that obviously
took
the time out. There's loads of people.
Unsung hero of the season.
Dom.
Tom.
Take us to Liverpool. Dom, legends. Tom. John.
And Tom always gets the burgers in after the game and all, doesn't he?
The £1.
Unsung hero. Go and start at your end this time.
Yeah, somebody who hasn't got the plaudits you think they deserve. I know mine. Do you want me to go first?
Go on.
Ogbonna.
That's what I was going to say.
Ogbonna, I think he's been... he had a bit of a shaky start. Obviously, he's foreign speaking. Didn't settle in straight away. Like, in the first couple of games, I didn't really fancy him to long it out. Do you know what I mean? I thought he'd be on the bench a lot. Especially, what game was it when he came off after Leicester. Like 20 minutes, 30 minutes?
It's Leicester.
Was it Leicester?
Was it Bournemouth?
No, Bournemouth. Mm. One of them anyway. And I thought, this kid ain't going to... recently, he's been an absolute rock. He's been superb. He's got good pace. I think he reads
the game well as well.
Huh?
He reads the game very well.
Yeah, I think as a defender that size, I think you've got to, because you're not gonna, you're not gonna clatter anyone. You're not gonna win anything in the air.
That's why I think him and Ginger played so well together. Ginger was the attack everything.
I could have gone for Ginger. I was quite tempted to go for Ginger, but Ogbonna for me, he's been a mainstay. It's been him and whoever else. You know, I think he's outshone everyone. I think he's outshone Reed. Obviously, Tompkins has not had much of a go, but Ginger's close to him, but Ogbonna for me all day long.
I'm going to go Kiarte. I think he's had a great season. He's been the engine in there, and he's done all the hard graft with the running up and down and tracking.
I think he gets enough plaudits, so I'm thinking about people who don't get mentioned.
For me, I'm going to say Randolph. When he's had to come in, he's done a job. And we all doubted him. But I think every time he's played, he's a bit shaky at the end of the season. But when you look overall, what he's done...
Some of the FA Cup games, he's superb.
He kept us in the FA Cup at Anfield, didn't he? And he's played well. And there was also a shout, I was close to saying Tompkins as well.
I was thinking Czech, but I think he's
an 8 out of 10 every week, and he always gets plaudits. But I know what you're saying, unsung hero. Who you got?
That's the same as Nicky Ogbonna.
You could even say someone like Obiang, because when he's come on, he's never really done anything wrong, has he? But he's never had a chance. He's played 12 appearances he made this season.
Nah, that's not enough for a player like you. But to be fair, that just shows you the depth we had in the squad this year. You know, when you've got players like Alex Song, who for the last third of the season didn't even get on the bench.
He ain't had a sniff all season.
No, he hasn't.
Due to the fact of how well Noble, Cech and Obiang, when he's come in, has played. You know, Obiang was probably bottom of that pecking order at the start of the season, and he's got above Song. And Song, on paper, is the better player of the four.
Mm. Most improved player?
Antonio.
I think, yeah. There's nobody. Do you know what? I'm going to go different. I'll let you go. You saying Antonio?
San Antonio.
I'm saying Antonio.
I'd say Lanzini for me. Started off a bit. I mean, he sort of grew into the season, didn't he?
I don't know. I thought he sort of...
You go into the first few games, like especially in Europe, when we was qualifying, people doubted him.
Mm.
But, I don't know. It's a tough one, isn't it?
My one's Noble.
See, I've always thought Noble was...
Mm. No, the thing is about Nobes, I don't really rate his ability, like... I know that's a harsh thing to say, especially when you see me playing football last week at Ball Street and I can't even move 5 yards.
Getting out of breath.
I said that at the start of the season, but...
But his ability...
He's proved me wrong.
Yeah, I never really see him as much of a ball player.
Mm.
I saw him as a dog work player. Someone who runs around like an headless chicken, getting in front of it. Sort of like, we met him recently, Robbie Savage. You know what I mean? Can't play football. Like, couldn't play much football. But would run around, get the ball and give it to people that can play. That's how I saw him. But some of his abilities this year, his passing has gone from there to there.
Yeah.
His passing abilities, the way he sprays the ball around, the shooting. I mean, there was about 10 weeks in a row when every week he'd dig one from 35 yards. And apart from a couple of good goalkeepers and probably a couple of posts, he scored a couple.
Mm.
But he could have had like 5, 6, 7... Like 35-yard screamers.
It's the confidence in the ability of the players you're playing with.
I think that breeds in when you've got people like Payet around the place. You know, you look at him, and then you look at last season when you had people like Matt Taylor playing in the midfield. You know what I mean? Like, to see him with that ability gives you the confidence to try things.
Mm.
And I think that's where, like, he might have been a bit more afraid to shoot last year because he thinks, oh, well, if I shoot, we might not get another chance. Whereas you've got people like Payet and Lanzini making chances. You know, it gives him more confidence because he thinks, right, I can hit this one because if I miss it, people ain't got to get my back because in 5 minutes' time, Payet's going to be creating another chance. We didn't have really them create players. I think that gives him more freedom to express, you know, what he can do, you know?
And it proves he's great in his locker. Look at his goal at Norwich.
Yeah,
that's a cracker. Somebody told me he said he's going to the bottom corner, though.
No, he admitted that on Fantasy Football Club, but...
It did bobble up as he...
Yeah, but it still went in, it still looked good.
Smasher.
But for me, Lanzini, I was going to say Ogbonna as well, because like you said, he didn't start off great, so... Yeah.
I think that everyone who we've said there has had a good shout, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. the worst player of the season. I'll start. Victor Moses. No.
They said it. They
said it. You can only have one.
Valencia. Do you know what? This one so differs in opinions because my brother thinks he's mustard.
Valencia?
Yeah. That's why he wears the glasses that big. my brother thinks he's mustard. And he says, like, you know, give him a chance and he'll prove it. He's been absolute awful. Every game he's played, bar Man City.
Yeah.
Bournemouth, he had a decent performance.
Two games out of how many?
however many. Is it?
For me, my worst player, I'll probably get abused for this. I'm going to say Sacco. Honestly, he ain't done nothing for me this season, especially his attitude towards the last few games, end of the season. He's been injured for most of it. How many goals he scored this season? Three,
seven?
Four?
Mm. No, I think it's seven.
No, I don't even think he scored that many, mate. And for someone that we thought was going to get us 20 goals, I'd get rid of him in the summer.
Do you think he's out like for a move?
Yeah, I hope he does. I hope Bilic gives him the move because there's better out there than him.
The thing is, you look at the start of the season, he worked his nuts off. That Liverpool game, you know, going up there, the way he played up there. he wouldn't, for me, he's not, yeah, his attitude, whatever the rumours are, whatever happened at the end of the season, it was bad timing for when it happened. But the way he was at the start of the season put us on the front foot to where we finished.
Mm.
Valencia, yeah, like two performances in the entire season.
So the thing is with Sacco, I know he had an injury in the middle of it, but what?
I just thought about my most improved player. Can I say it?
Yeah, of course you can.
Andy Carroll for me.
Yeah, that's a good shout as well.
I had that. I was thinking about it. I don't know why I said Lanzini, but it's the pressure of the cameras.
The worst, who are we talking about?
Worst player.
Worst player.
Yeah, but who's
Sacco.
About? Sacco. It's just the decline in him. The decline in his attitudes. He had a couple of arrests this year. He was
Jesus. Jesus, man. Was like a fucking dinosaur. Like T-Rex walked in.
It's just, yeah, his whole attitude is just, it, from last year, you see him last year coming from the French second division, full of smiles, full of confidence, you know, wanted to set the lid. This season, he looks more moody, he looks more upset. I know he's had problems at home, he's had a couple of arrests.
Do you know
he obviously
why?
Thinks he's a lot better than
what he is. Do you know
why?
Because he's not the main man this year.
Maybe.
Under Big Sam, he was the main man, he was the top goal scorer. Now, there's five or six players that are better than him.
Yeah.
He's not the one everyone's talking about.
Now, I don't even think he gets into the starting 11 if everyone's fit.
For me, he's my worst player of the season.
Scott?
Zerati.
Yeah, I
forgot
that.
About him.
All that promise at the start of the season.
Apart from his attitude, I don't think he's done that bad. I don't think he's done that bad. He's got some good goals.
He started the season, he had probably three or four good games.
It's a shame because he had so much potential,
Yeah.
But the games he was playing, we might have been playing with 10 men. He was like against Southampton, he was just strolling around. We might as well have had 10 men.
I think that's when his attitude started.
That's where your thing for Moses comes in. What game was it? Where one of the biggest cheers of the night is where he got took off.
Mm.
You know, in Moses, Zerati, Valencia.
One.
But no, I'm just saying it. No, we're the ones we've discussed, you know.
Yeah.
But then again, another one, Jenkinson.
Yeah, but he got injured.
But he was awful, he got injured.
Yeah.
Yeah, but he went in goal. That's why he gets it. He went
kept
in goal.
A clean sheet.
Yeah, he kept a clean sheet.
Right?
I was going to go Zerati. Not for his ability, just his general attitude towards the end. And it was.
Next one's point. Biggest letdown. Now this could be any players, games, season, whatever. Biggest letdown that you felt this season?
I was deflated when we lost that replay. Deflated. I could have took all the other defeats, but that one I thought we was in with a real shout this year. So I was, that for me.
Standard of refereeing. The biggest letdown
in
our season.
Good one.
It's cost us a lot this year. Cost us the FA Cup semi final. It's cost us probably fourth place in the league.
Semi final?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because if it,
the decision up at Old Trafford.
Exactly. You know, two decisions that you missed.
There was about six or seven in a row, weren't there?
Yeah.
To be honest.
You know, that's the biggest disappointment for me. Where we could have been. Yeah, you know, other teams are going to say it, but for me, that's what's, you know. It was a bit of an anticlimax towards the end of the season due to.
But in saying that about the decision up Old Trafford, we had another game to put it right.
Yeah.
And we didn't.
So, yeah. Why?
Mine would be the end of the season, the last three games. I know the.
The
last three games, I mean, like, apart from the last game at the bowling, the Swansea and the Stoke game where we could have got into Europe.
We got in the Champions League.
Yeah, Champions League is what I mean. It's for me, it was a great season. I'm not taking nothing away from this season.
Just took
but,
a shine off of it.
Yeah, it was to think we could have gotten in the Champions League, but still a great season.
Mm.
Yeah.
Of course it is.
Mine is Victor Moses.
Your mate, old Victor.
do you know what? The geezer come. I'm not even talking about particularly his performances on the pitch, which were dire in the last half of the season, would you say?
Mm-hmm.
But the attitude of the man, he's got some, you know, it's a personal thing probably, rather than a public thing, but I've told everyone what I saw at Newcastle. He was there, he backed me up. The attitude of the man, he's obviously not got the right attitude on the football pitch as well, because he started off the season so brightly. You know, he's got loads of promise, Victor Moses. He's got all the talent in the world when he wants to run it, but he's dangerous when he runs at players. He got a good shot on him. He showed that at Man City. He started brilliantly at Newcastle, you know, started the season. As soon as he got the injury, he came back and he wasn't a starter. He wasn't in the team because Lanzini had sort of taken his place by then. He just didn't want to know.
Just to back you up on that one, any player for me that's a journeyman like him is always got attitude problems because he can't stay at one club.
Why wouldn't Chelsea want him?
Liverpool had him, Stoke had him.
But Crystal Palace.
He'd probably go on loan to someone like Middlesbrough next year or someone
like
that.
At the age that he is, if your parent club thought you were any good, they would be keeping you. They wouldn't be loaning you out. You know, like maybe if you just come back from an injury, they might have loaned you out 6 months, but not.
If you're a journeyman, there's a reason why you're a journeyman.
You look at all the players that are a journeyman. They've always got problems, didn't they?
Yeah.
And his attitude did stink, but it's a shame because he's got so much potential, just like Ravel Morrison.
But it's getting players like him out and getting replacements that are, you know, improved the squad, which. That's the biggest disappointment for me, because I think he did improve the squad at the start.
Again, on paper, you look at the type of player he is, the pace he's got, the ability he's got,
the skill, like, the shot, he's got everything.
You know, he's what you want.
Yeah, do you know what? Even like the replay, I thought he came on the pitch in the last half, and he was the best player.
He was running at
you know, and that's what he lacked. I just think his attitude stank. I don't like what he did to the fans. As soon it seemed like this for him, as soon as they heard that we weren't signing any loan players, he just thought, oh God, he's probably started looking through the Premier League sticker book to see what club he could go to next.
To be fair, I sort of understand that in a way.
I think that's a bit of a mistake.
The performances, because at the end of the day, the club are paying your wages, and you should, whether you are happy or not, you should perform on that pitch. But I think it was a mistake for the club to come out and say that we're not signing the low players.
Yeah, but then if you put good performances in another club next season, the more likely they'll think, oh yeah, he's worth taking a punt on, and they might sign him.
Somebody take a punt on him.
It'd be a newly promoted club or someone
like Newcastle, if he drops down to the Championship.
He'd never drop down to the Championship.
But that's it, even someone like Borough, who's just coming up, wanting to improve
Borough,
his squad.
Burnley.
Experienced Premier League player.
Hull. Steve Bruce will take him.
Right. Big ones, big three now. The last three. Goal of the season.
Who's starting?
You go, right?
See, there's been so many. Mm. Yeah, you could sit here, you know. But for me, was Andy Carroll's winner against Chelsea, just for the stadium, how it erupted. The whole game, the Chelsea game was unbelievable.
Yeah.
But when Andy Carroll scored that winner, like, it's just had everything, didn't it?
Yeah.
You were so pleased for him. And yeah, I know we've had all the great goals and you'll probably mention the standout ones, but for me, my personal one was Andy Carroll, just for the ecstasy of when he scored that winner.
Yeah.
So you good say job. That.
I did.
But for me, it's the same sort of thing with a Bonner's goal against Liverpool.
Yeah.
You know, just the emotion and, you know, everything. You know,
it depends what way you want to go for it. That's an emotional goal, but do you want to go for technique? It depends.
Can we have emotion and technique? Because if you go with technique, there's only one goal for me, and that was Payet against Palace at home, the free kick for technique.
See, I'm going Payet, Old Trafford, free kick.
Palace was
just like, he's so far out. Even Nicky went, he ain't going to put
it. I can't remember it was against, but Antonio, the volley when he was going backwards.
Oh, Liverpool in the cup.
That one for me. You know, he was going backwards and he's hit in the air.
Bat his header against Tottenham. Yeah. A rocket.
Yeah.
Bat his header against Liverpool.
My favourite Payet goal this year. Let's go favourite Payet goal. We have a new subject.
Yeah. We're doing a Payet.
My favourite Payet goal this year was Crystal Palace away.
Yeah.
When he done that little dink over the keeper. Because I thought it was clever, I thought it was well worked.
Was it the main?
I mean, let's just talk through some of his goals. Well, I mean, Blackburn away, when he ran in.
Newcastle, the first goal we scored. That was his first West Ham goal, wasn't it?
Is that the one he put in the top corner?
Yeah, when he ran onto it.
Yeah, it was a great goal.
What was the one where he put a free kick? Who was it against?
Bournemouth.
Where he put a free kick. First free kick he missed, he gone one way. the keeper's set up as if he's going that way and he puts it completely in the other corner.
Is that
Pistol Palace?
Palace. Was that Menu?
No, I'm sure it's Palace, mate. He missed one to the left.
Yeah, and then he put it right on him. The right, yeah.
Yeah, that was Palace, yeah.
And the other one against either Menu or Man City, where he put it right in the corner. Right in the corner.
There's been some. It's not only Payet though. You, I mean, you.
Lanzini
against Everton.
Yeah, no, that was a great goal. Moses against Man City. That was a good goal.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There's been some cracking goals.
Yeah, we've been spoiled this year for goals, haven't we? Yeah.
Goal of season.
Antonio's.
Payet, Old Trafford.
I say Payet, Crystal Palace. And he dinked it over the keeper. I just like the technique. But for emotion, the Reed. The Reed goal.
The last one of the season.
Emotion.
So the emotion's on Bonner for me, Liverpool.
Yeah, that's my one, you know, because it's grand. Because I was going to run, I'm going to go and hide in the toilet. He's going to penalty. He's like, come get me after.
For me, I mean, Carroll, like, I could even say Carroll against Arsenal.
Yeah.
When we went 3-2 up, because that one brought me to fucking tears.
Yep.
Yeah.
Literally, because how it just went, like, from 2-0 down against Arsenal. But yeah, for when he scored that winner against Chelsea, everything about that Chelsea game I loved. Mourinho getting sent off. Everything.
11, I don't even know whether we should say this. Player of the season.
Why don't you do, right, because we're all going to say Payet,
yeah?
Why don't we take Payet out of it then?
Oh, we'll take Payet out. That's was you going to say Payet?
Yeah, Payet, yeah.
It's obvious.
Yeah. Everyone said Payet, but we're going to go second.
Antonio.
Noble
for me.
Good shout, yeah. Antonio.
Noble for me because I love him, but Antonio is a very, very, very close second.
It's like that.
Antonio. I love the kid. He's you know, from what we were saying about him at the beginning, I was very critical of him. I didn't think he'd ever make it.
It wasn't only just though, but, there was fans all over the one we spoke to people.
He's not the most technically gifted player. He's a confidence player, that's for sure.
But for me,
it's his attitude.
Yeah.
He'd go his goal if you asked him.
If you could put that attitude he's got into every other player in the team.
Do you know what I love? Yeah, he plays with a smile on his face, and he looks like he enjoys stepping on that pitch.
And he will do actually anything to keep his.
And when he's been asked to play right back for an extended period of time,
you don't see this a lot in footballers anymore. But he breaks his neck to score goals.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. You know, literally like that Man United goal that he scored, the header.
Mm. You know, he was never going to lose that header, was he?
Anyone else might have just stopped. Like if that had been Sakho standing there, he probably would have just stopped and put his hand up, acknowledged a good ball. But you know, I like a player that actually goes for I don't see it enough these days. Yeah, like
players don't jump no more.
They don't seem to.
If it's not to their feet or it goes a little bit wide, I don't want to move.
Like me in Powerling.
That's it. Yeah. You know, he's got where Ginger throws his body in front of trying to stop.
It's not only that, he defends as well.
He's
up and down them wings. Look,
we lose the ball, he's one of the first players running back. And how many times through the years have we seen a player get into the attacking 18-yard box, we lose the ball, and then he's just like, jogs back, because I've got up here so someone else, you know, but he sprints, he's trying to get there.
And let's talk about your guy, Noble. How much of an influence has he been on the season?
Massive.
He's been
immense this season.
He's definitely wrong.
And it's nice for him to captain the club in this important season. And
captain the club in the important season next year as well.
I can't speak highly enough of him.
To be honest with you, like looking back, I was calling for Reed to be the captain.
Mm-hmm.
And I know Reed scored that good goal, which sort of made up for him not being captain. Mm. Do you know what I mean? But there's no one you would want more than him to captain like the team in this season, like the last at the bowling.
I'll tell you one thing, you'll never see it again.
No, I don't think
you'll never
will
see a local lad captain West Ham again.
Yeah, but no, we've got some youngsters coming through. But no, you're probably right. Not at the bowling anyway.
Yeah, definitely not the bowling.
No, but what I don't think is, I don't think you'll ever see, unless you know we go on to, you know, unprecedented heights. I don't think you'll see someone staying there for as long. Do you know what I mean? But
very much that you'll get.
I mean, I think he'll see out the rest of his career with us.
Yeah.
Of course he will, yeah.
It's going to be...
You don't know what's going to happen with West Ham. If money comes in, we start bringing all in all these big players like what Man City done and that, someone like Mark Noble would probably move on.
I still
and
think
that's the gutting thing about it.
That's going to happen. The money's going to come. The players are going to come.
Yeah, but that might not happen for 3 years. And in 3 years' time, Noble will be, what, how old is he now? 29? So it'd be 30, 33.
You still need that core of English players.
I believe that, yeah, I do believe that.
You look at Chelsea, right? All the money that are pumped into Chelsea. I know like we're looking at a different standard player, but the backbone of Chelsea with John Terry and Frank Lampard. You know, and teams need that, and they need, to me, it's got to be an English backbone.
Yeah, but United
well.
Always had that, Arsenal had that.
Yeah, exactly, that's what I'm saying, the English backbone. You can have all the good players you want, unless you've got them players that know what it's like.
Yeah, and what, I don't particularly you know. Think they have to be English. I just think they've got to have that attitude, you know. When you look at the likes of Man City, like, Otamendi, on paper, is a very, very good defender.
Yep.
But I wouldn't want him... in my team, if we the chips were down, do you understand what I mean?
No.
Like Sterling, very very good technical player. When we're losing 3-0 and we need a point to get something, yeah. I don't want him running around because I don't think he tries.
You want the players that the club means something to him.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what I said with Chelsea. You had it with John Terry. You had it with.
You've only got to look at Eden Hazard.
Yeah,
you've only got to look at him like for that example. Let's not talk about too much about him, but like just for that example, yeah, he was fantastic when it was all going right. As soon as it all started going wrong, he went hiding.
Yeah.
The only game he turned up for was to stop Tottenham winning the league, which I think is an absolute atrocity, to be honest, apart from stopping Tottenham winning the league, which I think is fantastic. But
in a way, a bit like Zerati,
one game.
In a bit like Zerati in this season. When everything was going well, we looked a good player. As soon as we started needing players to put a bit of graft in, put a bit of effort in, because players got injured.
Yeah, he got shipped out as soon as that happened. Mm. Right.
To be fair, there's probably other few players. Ginge, Lanzini, if he wanted to get injured, he could have been up there. But everyone's had a great season, really.
Last one. Before I go back. Are you all right?
Yeah, sorry. Clear me front.
Favourite memory of the season? What will you take away from this season, never forgetting for the rest of your life?
Say one moment in there. When you bought a pint. it's got to be the last game of the season, isn't it? The bowling, farewell bowling, the whole day for me.
You can't.
Drunk as a skunk, can't remember a lot of it.
You can't top that, can you?
Yeah, it was the whole.
The day was brilliant.
Day, night.
I don't. And I'm not just talking about the game. I'm talking about. Congregating outside with people, you know, a proper party, getting there nice and early, getting my first pint in the bowling on a match day. You know, everything about it was just, it was perfect.
And for me, it was getting out of work early.
No, it was just a perfect day.
It was, everything went well. And then we're going to forget about all them things that went on with the media and that, because I'm not remembering it for that. I'm remembering being with my mates, like, enjoying that last game, going to the pub
in the middle of the road,
packing the streets out,
sitting with him in the last game of the season,
crying.
No, good. There's only one memory for me that I'll take away.
Can I chuck another one in?
Of course you can, mate. Sure.
I say like that. That was the away game that we went to. Scott didn't make it, but the first game away to Arsenal, the atmosphere in the away end that day.
The outside for me at the Emirates was that they were some of the best fan cams. Yeah. That was when we really launched our channel, wasn't it? Because that took us all by surprise.
Yeah.
Just seeing all them people jumping around us, and
especially when that second
Nicky
goal
getting crumbled.
My face.
I still watch it there, it still cracks me up.
But then this is why I like having the channel, because you can look back at them now. I've gone back to them recently and had a good look. I mean, some of them got some good views. Mm. I mean, some of them got 50,000 views.
Yeah. And we only had, that Arsenal game, how many subscribers we have? 700?
700, yeah. Just unbelievable. Mm. Unbelievable scenes. My one was the 1-1 draw West Brom.
The 0-0 at Swansea.
Nah, it's the last game of bowling, of course.
Yeah,
of course.
It's got to be in it.
Unbelievable season. Mm-hmm. Unbelievable season. And I'm very much looking forward to the next.
You've got to look at the season. There's so many memories to walk away from.
Yeah.
The only thing it was missing is we didn't win a trophy.
Yeah.
The 50 years at Liverpool, ending that in style.
We ended a lot of, we won at City.
Arsenal. City. I won't say it, but 50 years is a fucking long time. Not to beat someone.
My dad was at school last time we went to Anfield.
Everton was about 10 years, wasn't it? Since we won. Yeah,
10 years I can remember. Yeah. 50 years, you're talking about back in the days when we won the World Cup.
Mm.
Yeah. Do you know what I mean?
Before we won.
Before.
But you look at going to grounds like Everton, you know, and coming away winning now.
Yeah.
You know, they're grounds that we normally go up to.
No, and you look at when we was 2-0 down at places and we've come back and either nicked a win or a draw. West Ham and I wouldn't have done that.
We've not lost to any of the top teams this year. Like the top teams, what you would class as the normal top teams. obviously, Leicester and Tottenham have sort of got in there this year.
We've put 5 goals past Arsenal in 2 games.
We've got 7 past Liverpool in 3.
No one ever done the double over us this season.
No.
Yeah, when was the last time we scored?
It's going to be hard to top that next season.
But do you know what? I was just about to say that. Can we replicate it? Can we go to these places again thinking, oh, fuck it, we can do that again?
I don't see why not.
We can go to these places and win, yeah.
I think football's changed now, isn't it? No one fears anyone anymore.
I think this season has proved that it ain't so much if you've got a lot of money, you're going to guarantee win things.
The thing is, the players will know now as well that they can go to these places.
I think Leicester have shown it, haven't they?
Mm.
Team spirit and work rate.
What you got to realise as well is United getting Mourinho, Man City getting Guardiola, Chelsea getting Conte. It's going to be a massive season next year, and they're all going to sign big players.
But the thing is, it's not necessarily that you're going to get Mourinho. Right, he's got a proven track record in the Premiership, but Guardiola, I don't know what the Premiership's like. He's a good manager when he's with a good side and a load of money behind him, but he don't know what the Premiership's like.
I'm going to make a prediction. Do you know what? Make a bold prediction for this Premier League season, because I'll make mine. I'm going to say Conte is going to fall right on his arse at Chelsea.
You reckon?
Yeah, I do. I don't think he's going to know what the fuck's hit him, to be honest, coming to this league. I don't care how good of a manager. This might come back to bite me in the arse. Like, might come back to
taunt me. That's a bold prediction. He's saying that we could all sit here and say,
they probably won't do as bad, and it obviously depends on signings, but I don't think it doesn't impress me. Like getting them sort of, I'm not saying he doesn't impress me, I don't know enough about him, but sort of them big name appointments. Van Gaal at Man United, he's absolutely fell on his arse there, really.
He didn't do too bad. He won the FA Cup and finished us outside Champions League.
I think
he got harsh criticism,
massively. And I think Van Gaal's, you know, Man U fans want Mourinho. The style of football's not much different.
He's very pragmatic.
Yeah.
But he will attract big players.
Not only will he attract big players, he'll get more time than he got.
That's exactly what it is.
Bold prediction for this season.
For this season, Man City finishing out the Champions League spot.
Really?
Yeah.
Why do you think that?
As I said, I just think Guardiola don't know what the Premier League's about.
Just a quick one, because we want to wrap it up.
I think Tottenham will probably be there or thereabouts again.
They could win it.
I think they'll be there or thereabouts.
Right.
I think a team that finished in the top 10 this season will be relegated next season.
Right, brilliant. Right, thanks very much.
I've had enough, by the way.
Thank you very much for joining us for this season review. We'll be back all through the summer. Don't forget to subscribe. We're going to be doing some England stuff. Scott's going to be kicking something off next week before the Euros. We've got some stuff to give away. Leave a comment down below if any of these questions you want to answer, any of these, what we just went through, game of the season, worst of the season, leave your comments down below. Anyone that, we'll pick one at random. I've got a Euro 2016 football and scarf. We'll give that away. And also, we'll do it for your one with the other stuff. But so do that. Leave comments down below. Like the video. Share it around. We always like to be shared. Last time I asked someone to share it around, we got 60,000 views. Me sitting in my car. So we'll be back all over the summer. Ryan's going to be coming up with his roundup every day. Yeah, transfer roundups.
Once I saw me loft out.
Left out, yeah. People love them little roundups, man. You've got to do more of them.
So, no, I'm talking about it. You don't know what you're talking about.
So we'll be back. Graham's going to be back with on the social. Scott's going to be kicking something off next week. That leaves me to sit in a deck chair and watch his all working terribly, terribly hard.
Well, no change there then.
So, yeah, thanks for joining us. Don't forget to follow us on Twitter at West Ham Fan TV, facebook.com/West Ham Fan TV, Instagram, West Ham Fan TV, Snapchat, although I don't know how to use it. We'll work it out in the summer, I promise. West Ham Fan TV, across all social media, our website, www.westhamfan.tv. Brilliant season, boys. We'll wrap it up there. One thing left to say. Come on, you ones.